Good morning, everyone. I'm Pastor James Graham, and I'd like to share with you the upcoming events here at Centenary United Methodist Church. On October the 22nd, we will be dedicating our pledges to God during our worship service. So you should have received a pledge card by this time, along with a letter from the church. We encourage you to prayerfully consider your giving in the coming year and bring those to church with you on the 22nd as we join together in presenting our gifts to God. On October the 29th, we will be having a United Methodist Men's Chili Cook-Off following our worship service at noon in the Activity Center. We encourage you to bring your submission, and hopefully you can take home the trophy for the best chili from Centenary United Methodist Church. This is a fundraiser which goes to support the United Methodist Men's Mission, especially the Thanksgiving and Christmas baskets that we give to needy families. So I hope you'll come and join us for a lot of good food and a good time together. On October the 29th at 4 o'clock in the evening, we will be hosting our annual charge conference and six other churches in our area. Our district superintendents will be here, and the order of the business of the day will be to receive charge conference forms from all of the churches to vote on pastors' compensations and to take care of the annual business of the church. We hope that you'll come and join us for a time as we celebrate our successes in ministry and look forward to the year to come. And now let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Come, Holy Spirit, fill this place with your peace. Fill our hearts that they might overflow with joy as we celebrate your love for us. We pray these things through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
As we worship today, I invite you to sit, to stand, to come to the altar. However you connect with God, that's all we ask for you today.
I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures of faith are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together. Desire is now satisfied here in your love. With one voice we proclaim there's nothing better. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Amen. Turn shame into glory. Your turn shame into glory. You're the only one who cares. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who cares. You're the only one. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Your hands, known and loved by you. Before I took a breath, when I doubted, Lord, remind me I'm wonderfully made. You're an artist and a potter, I'm the canvas and the clay. You are together for my future and for my good. You make all things work together for your glory and for your name. There's a healing light just beyond the clouds. Though I've walked through the fire, I see clearly now. I know nothing has been wasted, no failure or mistake. You're an artist and a potter, I'm the canvas and the clay. You make all things work together for my future and for my good. You make all things work together for your glory and for your name. I doubt it, Lord, remind me I'm wonderfully made. You're an artist and a potter, I'm the canvas and the clay. And I know nothing has been wasted, no failure or mistake. You're an artist and a potter, I'm the canvas and the clay. When I doubt it, Lord, remind me I'm wonderfully made. You're an artist and a potter, I'm the canvas and the clay. And I know nothing has been wasted, no failure or mistake. You're an artist and a potter, I'm the canvas and the clay. And you make all things work together for my future and for my good. You make all things work. not finished with me. No, you're not finished with me, yeah. You're not finished with me. You're not finished with me, yeah.
Have anything you're worried about? Yeah. There's plenty to worry about, but today we're talking about how we take those worries and we give them back to God through prayer and through rejoicing. But also how we avoid the pitfalls of just sticking our fingers in our ears and going, la 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 la, I can't hear my worries, I'm rejoicing right now, la la la, right? That balance of actually taking on what is going on in the world and working with God to build the kingdom of God. We have a beautiful image of God walking with us and being our shepherd found in the 23rd Psalm, and that will be our call to worship today. Will you read it with me? The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. Amen. We continue in our worship. After the mission moment, we'll sing another song, and during that song, we'll collect our offering as we respond to the good things that God has given us by giving back to God through the church and supporting its ministries. So we have a mission moment today highlighting why one of our members of Centenary gives thanks and gives to this congregation. This year for our stewardship series, we are sharing some testimonies from church members about why they give to Centenary and what they're thankful for. Today, we hear from Marlene Bonwell.
My name is Marlene Bonwell, and I've been a member of Centenary since 1990 when my late husband, Mert, and our son, Patrick, joined the Centenary family. I'm proud to belong to the church known for caring for the community, especially our downtown neighbors. My passion for Centenary and my church family goes beyond Sunday. Helping with Logos and our youth program has been my love for over 30 years. Our money continues to support our free neighborhood breakfast, and we've been able to add the clothes closet and showers. We've also helped with Family Promise, and we've housed, fed, and entertained Youth Force and the Bike and Build organization when they pass through Lawton. We open our doors and turn on the lights for civic organizations wishing to meet here. We keep the kitchen running and the dishwasher humming for the Methodist Men's Italian Dinner, the Women's Girlfriends Lunch, and our fifth Sunday potlucks, which also include the Youth Pie Auction, which is my favorite. We are the hands and feet of Jesus. So when you get your commitment card in the mail, hold it in your hands and prayfully pray for God's guidance to continue to financially support Centenary. My giving, like yours, helps to decide the budget for next year. We all have been hit with skyrocketing prices. And remember, when your utilities go up, imagine what the church pays to keep this beautiful historic building running. We want Centenary and all of our programs to grow and thrive in the future. Belonging to the big church downtown that supports the community makes my heart happy.
Thank you. Introduced me to your love. You picked up all my pieces, put me back together. You are the defender of my heart.
Just gonna stay still.
loving God. You have been with us. You have walked with us. You have sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to live among us. Your Holy Spirit continues to fill our lungs with breath. Walk with us together as a congregation. As we come together to worship you and to serve you and to be in your ministry. Grant us the strength to go into the world, to feed the hungry, to heal the sick, and to eat with sinners. Give us the boldness to proclaim your good news. Walk with those in our community who are struggling with homelessness, with poverty, with hunger. Be present with those who are isolated and alone, with those who struggle to get through each day. May you provide for them out of your abundance and out of the generosity of your people. We pray that you would walk with this world, that you would be with its people, that you would guide its leaders, and that you would provide peace, that you would provide protection and safety, that your love and your compassion would abound in powerful ways, that people would look out for one another and love their neighbor. Pray that you would walk with those who are going through illnesses, who are struggling with injury, that you would strengthen the people who are giving them care. We pray that you would be with those who are mourning, that your spirit of comfort and peace would surround them, that you would turn their mourning to dancing. You would walk with them to the valley of the shadow of death. You know, God, whatever other burdens and worries and concerns we bring with us this day, we lay them down at your feet, trusting that you hear us when we pray. We pray together all of these things in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us turn to our scripture today in Philippians 4, 1 through 9. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, you whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, dear friends. I plead with the Euodia, and I plead with Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you, my true companion, help these women since they have contended at my side in the cause of the gospel, along with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again. Rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice. And the God of peace will be with you. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Melt us, mold us, fill us, use us. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Amen. One time when I was young, I was riding with my parents, because when you're young, you're always riding with your parents. And we were on our way to some event. And as we were riding, I was in the back seat of the minivan, and I start to hear this weird noise outside. Probably something like a th 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 th. I'm like, that's weird. Hey, Dad, do you hear that? He goes, I think we were already late, too. He goes, no, that's nothing. I don't hear anything. But we kept driving along, and we finally were, so that at that point we were on paved road, but anytime you want to get somewhere in Ringling, it usually involves driving on a dirt road at some point. So we turn off onto the dirt road, and it's a bumpy dirt road, but then all of a sudden it gets really bumpy. And we stop. Dad gets out of the car, goes to the left rear tire that I was sitting by, and sees that it is flat. It is very flat. And I knew enough, even at that young age, to not say, I told you so, but I thought, I told you so. I heard that. I heard the th-th-th-th-th-th-th before it became a b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b-b- It might be the check engine light. It might be that little sound rattling around somewhere in the car, and you think, that's fine. That's fine. I'm just not going to worry about it. I don't have time to worry about it. I don't want to pay the money to worry about it. I'm just going to ignore it and hope that it goes away. La, 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 la. This is not a problem. We're just going to keep driving forward. There are all kinds of things in life that come up like that. Those kinds of worries or concerns that our approach is to just keep on driving and hope nothing happens. Well, that might be what we are accused of if we take Paul's advice to the Philippians to not worry about anything, but to rejoice. Oh, I'm not worried about that. I'm too busy rejoicing. La, 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 la. Hear my joy. La, 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 la. Rejoice, rejoice. That's not a problem. Look somewhere else. Look over here. We're rejoicing. That's that leak behind the stage. That's not a problem. It'll fix itself, right? There's not a leak behind the stage. Just kidding. Right? We might be accused of just trying to stick our heads in the sand and kind of bury out and drown out the worries, just going on about our lives. And just like with a tire that's going down, all of a sudden going really down, sometimes those problems do come back to bite us. If we don't address them, if we don't at least acknowledge the problems around us, if we don't call a roofer to come back and please, please come back and try a patch again on this roof. Don't worry, that will get replaced soon, I hope, and the leak. There's not a leak back there. What are you talking about? Where the horse trough is. Right? We gotta like acknowledge the problems, acknowledge the worries, and address them from time to time. We can't just ignore them. But we might be tempted to want to drown them out with our rejoicing and with our prayer and just hope that everything will be okay. And while rejoicing and prayer, they are powerful things, and I hope that you can tell that I'm structuring this sermon to kind of go through the ways that we can misuse them and come back to say the way that we can responsibly use rejoicing and prayer. That's where we're headed. But if we unresponsibly use rejoicing and prayer and stick our heads in the sand, we're missing the point. That's not the advice that Paul is giving to the Philippians and to us today. That kind of thought kind of goes down to the way that the phrase thoughts and prayers is used today. It's kind of become a catch-all kind of plaster over the problem kind of phrase, especially in the aftermath of a tragedy, perhaps a shooting or a disaster, when somebody gets up to the microphone and says, our thoughts and prayers are with the victims. And then the response is, well, that's what are you doing to actually solve the problem? What are you doing to actually, like, your prayer's not bringing back the person I lost. Your prayer's not changing policy failures. Your prayer's, what am I supposed to do with that? In fact, it's kind of become, out in the culture, a snarky response, thoughts and prayers, if you, like, really don't think that the person's problem's that big of a deal. Like, oh, no, your Ferrari didn't start this morning and you had to take the Land Rover. Thoughts and prayers. So we don't want to just kind of ignore our worries, and we don't want to plaster over them with thoughts and prayers. But we also don't want to become so overwhelmed and overtaken by our worries and our anxieties that we just kind of give in to nihilism and give up and say, Jesus, take the wheel. I'm not dealing with this anymore. This is too much. This is overwhelming. No, we need some kind of way to address our worries, to give them to God, and to continue to move on with the lives that God has called us to live. So what should we do if not rejoice and pray? Well, we should do what Paul says, and we should rejoice and we should pray. But we should do it responsibly and the right way. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I will say rejoice. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. And while that might sound naive or over-optimistic, that just always be rejoicing, everything will be okay. You might think, rejoice? How could I rejoice in a time like this? I'm too worried. I'm too overwhelmed. How can I rejoice? Don't worry. Have you ever started a sentence, don't worry, that ends well? Don't worry, Mom, but everything's okay, but right? It's like trying to tell somebody to calm down. It usually doesn't calm them down very much. Calm down. You don't tell me to be calm. I'm perfectly calm right now. Don't worry. Don't worry. Well, Paul, if I'm not going to worry, what do you want me to do? And Paul says, you can pray. You can take your worries to God. Well, we don't want it to devolve into the worst cliched use of thoughts and prayers. We do have this outlet to refocus ourselves, to take our worries and our anxieties and put them into context and remember who is walking with us through them. This week especially, rejoice, don't worry, be happy about everything. That seems even feeble, or as feeble as ever, for advice. We've watched as war has broken out in Israel and in Gaza, people dying, terrible and violent deaths. I'm not here to give you a political take on it. I'm just here to say that people dying violent deaths is bad. Well, it seems like a really good time to pray. It struggles to be a good time to rejoice. How could we rejoice right now over this violence? And that's not the only bad thing going on in the world. How can we rejoice in these difficult times? It feels also like a pretty good time to worry. Rejoice in the Lord always, Paul? Really? Is this the part of always you were talking about? Paul, what kind of advice are you trying to give to us? What are you talking about? What are you trying to... Where are you even at, Paul? Oh, yeah. He's sitting in prison. As Paul is writing this letter to the Philippians, he's in jail. And he may even have a death sentence over his head at this point. Early in the letter to the Philippians, he's contemplating whether or not it would be better to live or to die. That's how close he thinks he is to death. He says to die is to gain Christ. He'd be out of that terrible situation. He'd be at peace. He'd be with Christ. But he'd also be missing the people that he's been in ministry with and know that there's still work left to do. He's actually weighing his mortality sitting in this prison. It's a dark place to be. It's that dark place that we go to. when we're overwhelmed, when our hope is thin, when our reasons to rejoice are few. It's that dark place when our prayers become more pleas and cries for help. God, I don't know what to do. I am overwhelmed in this moment. But it's in this dark place, it's in this prison cell that Paul can write a letter to his brothers and sisters in Philippi and say, rejoice always in the Lord. And again, I say rejoice. How can he tell the Philippians not to worry? How can he tell the Philippians to be sure of your prayers? It is because the Lord is near. He says, rejoice, the Lord is near. Even in the darkness of that prison cell, he knows that God is with him. And that wherever God is, there is the new life offered to us through Christ. A life transformed by the grace and forgiveness of God through the example of Jesus Christ. He reminds the Philippians why we can rejoice. He says, let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited. But he emptied himself, taking on the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. It's Paul's beautiful, poetic way of saying, God came to live with us in the form of Jesus Christ, lived a human life, emptied himself, and even went through the worst thing humans go through, which is death. And not just a regular death, a terrible death on a cross. God is with us, Paul reminds us, but the story doesn't end there. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every other name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Even in through that emptiness, through pouring himself out, through suffering death on the cross, God raised Jesus up from the grave, exalted him into heaven, and we can rejoice too because we share in that resurrection. We are lifted up in the same new life with Jesus Christ. We can rejoice because God is with us. We can rejoice because Jesus is alive. We can rejoice because the Holy Spirit continues to work with us. And through us, we can turn our worries over to God. For it is God who is at work in you, enabling you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. That's Paul again. He's saying we've got work to do. But the work that we do is only because of God. All those good things, the way that this church serves the community that Marlene talked about in her testimony, that comes from God. God placed the desire to love your neighbor into your hearts and gives you the strength each and every day to get up and to answer that call and to share that love of God with the people around you. So that even when the world seems like it is falling apart, even when we're surrounded by worries and anxieties, and troubles and disaster, God is still walking with us and guiding our work. We can rejoice because the Lord is near, because God is with us. But also we look around and realize it's not just the Lord who is with us. The people of the Lord are with us too. Paul named several people in his letter to the Philippians. And he didn't just name them so that it would be harder for us to read the passages 2,000 years later trying to get through those Greek names. Gus did a beautiful job getting through those Greek names. He named Eudoa and Synecdoche. No, that's an English term. And Clement and all of the people whose names are listed in the book of life, because it is other people who he is laboring with who give him hope for the church. It is these other people who he is working with. He acknowledges their hard work and their sacrifice and the things that they are doing to help build the church and to build the kingdom of God. That gives him hope. That gives him reason to rejoice that he is not sitting in prison alone. But the people of God are out in the world doing the work of God. He also names another person, Epaphroditus. We're going to call him Epi. Epi was sent by the Philippians with gifts and with resources to go minister to Paul, to go to where Paul was imprisoned and bring him food and comfort and to just sit with him. And this other fellow Christian, this other follower of Jesus who went and ministered to Paul, that journey must have been difficult and long, because when he gets there, he gets really sick, nearly to the point of death. But Paul writes that God spares his life and he's restored to health and he's sent back to the Philippians. But it's this beautiful witness of the church in Philippi coming together and putting their resources together and sending Epi out to go care for Paul in his time of need. It's a reminder that we are not alone in this work, that we have the people of the Lord around us, that God is with us, but we're also with each other in community with one another, doing the work of God together. We can rejoice together. We can pray together because we are not alone. God is with us. So when we rejoice and when we pray, we're not ignoring the problems of the world. We're actually taking them head on to say that our God is bigger than them and that we are not addressing them alone. And when we take our worries and our concerns and our anxieties to God in prayer, it helps us to refocus, gives us that outlet to let go of that anxiety and to focus on where God is at work, to not be overwhelmed by the negative, to think about the good things that God is doing. We do not focus on our worries. Instead, we can think about whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing to God, whatever is commendable, whatever is worthy of praise. We can think about these things instead and focus on what God is calling us to do about those problems in the world. This weekend, I got to go to annual conference, another special called session of annual conference. While some people might groan at having to go to another meeting, I actually love going to annual conference. It's like a big family reunion because it reminds me of all of the other United Methodists across the state of Oklahoma that are also working to build the kingdom of God. And as we were there at the conference, and unfortunately part of the business was saying goodbye to some churches who were leaving the denomination and to some churches that were closing. But as part of our time together, we had communion. And we were reminded that we are all one in the body of Christ. And we're in this auditorium. And as we go to receive communion at the different stations, I'm walking around and through aisles, and I see people that I know. I'm shaking hands with friends, and we're seeing, and I see other people doing the same, and it's just this time of great fellowship and excitement that we are the body of Christ. We've been called together to do this work. It doesn't make our problems smaller. It doesn't make the challenges easier. But it does remind us that we have the support to address them, that we have the courage to take on whatever the world throws at us with the help of God, that we together are called to build the kingdom of God. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we celebrate being in the presence of God, rejoice, the Lord is near. And as we celebrate being in fellowship with one another, we respond to God's call on our lives. We respond to the worries with prayer and supplication. So we go into this time of prayer. I invite you to light a prayer candle as a sign of light shining through the darkness. As a reminder, we can take our anxieties to God in prayer, and that God's Spirit and God's people will be walking with us as we face whatever challenges lie ahead. Let us continue in worship.
Does your kindness extend the path from where your feet rest on the sunrise to where you sweep the sinners past? Oh, how fast would you come running if just a shadow through the night and trace my steps through all my failures until you walk me out that other side. For who could dare ascend that mountain, that valleyed hill called Calvary? And to the one I call Good Shepherd, who like a lamb was slain for me. Oh, I will praise you on the mountains, and I will praise you in the mountains in my way. You're the summit where my feet are, so I will praise you in the valleys all the same. No less God within the shadows, no less faithful when the night leads me astray. You're the heaven where my heart is. In the highlands, in the heartache, all the same. Oh, mountains, wherever I stand. And if ever I walk through the valley of death, I'll sing through the shadows my song of ascent. Whatever I walk through, wherever I am, your name can move mountains, wherever I stand. And if ever I walk through the valley of death, I'll sing through the shadows my song of ascent, my song of ascent. Oh, 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 sing it out, my song of ascent. Oh, oh, from the gravest of all valleys come the pastures we call grace. A mighty river flowing upwards from a deep but empty grave.
Thank you, God, for what you do for us, God, for allowing us to come to your altar, to come before your feet, to know you, to hear you speak to us, God, to be able to talk and walk with you every day. We thank you for that nearness, that closeness that you always provide, God. Even when we're anxious and afraid, even when we can't see it, God, we rejoice that you are near. We rejoice that you are our Savior, that you are greater than anything that can come before us, ahead of us, God. You are stronger. Your love is deep and wide and gracious. And we just thank you for that, God. We thank you for what you're doing in our lives. We thank you for what you're doing in this church. We pray that we continue to be your hands and feet in this kingdom, in this town, in this community. And we continue to come together for your glory and your name. It's in your Son's name that I ask these things. Amen. Let us stand as we close with one more song. We worship the God who was, we worship the God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory, amen. There's joy in the house of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Oh, oh, oh. We shout out your praise. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung up on that cross, then he rose up from that grave. My God's still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Oh, oh, oh. We shout out your praise. 'Cause we were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. 'Cause we were
the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There is joy. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Oh, oh, oh. We shout out your praise. Oh, oh, oh.
Rejoice. God is with us. Rejoice. We are not alone. Rejoice. God hears us when we pray. Rejoice. We are working together to build the kingdom of God. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Go now in peace. Amen.
Prodigals come home. The helpless find hope. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Prison doors swing wide, the dead come to life. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Miracles take place.